Sometimes we find ourselves in that way. And there's a scripture that I want to open up with. It's in Psalms chapter 16, verses 11. And it says, you, talking about God, you will show me the path of life. So we're talking about direction. When you have a life that is full, a life that is full of life, a life that is full of joy, that is full of peace, you seem to have a direction in life. But there are times when we're down and we have to look to someone, and he says, you will show me the path of life. Many times we don't know where to go, but God will show us the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. Not just a measure, not just a fraction, but there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So the straight out of life. When the straight out of life comes, it seems like you're straight out of money, right? You got more bills than you got money. You got more debt than you feel you will ever be able to pay. Sometimes the straight out of life, you're straight out of friends. When things are good, when you're able to pay for a round of drinks, when you're able to take people here and there or go to on vacations or go to all these different things, friends are there. But when your life comes on the hard knocks, where are the friends? Or when the party the night before is over and you're left alone in your room and you wake up in the morning after a party and it was all fun and games the night before, but then you realize that in the morning your life is still the same without friends, without fullness in life, without all these things, you realize my life is not where I want it to be. It's on empty. Maybe you're straight out of a job. Been looking and looking and looking for a job. They're able to pay for a decent living. Or maybe you're in a job that just is just tearing you down. Or maybe you're straight out of health. Maybe you're in a certain health circumstance in your life. Or maybe there's a parent, there's a family member that is undergoing extreme sickness in their lives. Or maybe it's straight outside. It may look like you've got it all handled. It's all good in the hood, at least on the outside. People want to be with you. People want to be around you. People want to hang out with you. But they don't see the inside of what's going on in your life. There's a lot of people with a lot of money, with a lot of things to do, with a lot of fame, and a lot of all these things that we think are symbols of people having together. But on the inside, we have to look and find out what's going on in their heart. Is there contentment? Is there peace? Is there love? Is there joy? Or is it based on circumstances? So when circumstances change, their life changes. Someone who lives in the straight out of life lives by the motto, I ain't got nothing. I don't know if you've ever felt, you've been in a place in your life where you feel like, I got nothing. I got nothing to show for my life. I'm whatever age I am, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. Look where I am, and I've got nothing to show for my life. Or people are asking of me. People are always asking something from me. They want me to volunteer. They want me to help out. They want me to do this. But I've got nothing because I'm tired. I'm stressed. So all this talk about living a soulful life, what happens when your life is on empty? Well, I want to share with you a story. Story about three kings in the Bible, three kings and a prophet. You know, when you get a chance, you go back home, look at 2 Kings chapter 3. 2 Kings chapter 3 is a story of three kings and a prophet. In fact, if you were to read it, it kind of reads like a movie, like an epic movie that you would go to the theater and watch for like 3 hours long because it's just this big story. It starts off with an unholy alliance. This alliance between these three kings that never should have happened. Never should have happened because of the players involved. After, I don't know if you know this about the history of the nation of Israel, but the nation of Israel at one point was one kingdom when it first started, when it first came into being, one kingdom. But because of the sins of King Saul, the first king, the Lord says that the kingdom would be divided. There would be the kingdom of Judah, and then there would be the kingdom of Israel. Some of the kings served God, some of the kings did not serve God. There was a king called Jehoram. He was the son of King Ahab, who was the king of Israel. King Ahab was an evil man. You ever heard of the Queen Jezebel? He was married to that woman. So they were unholy. There were evil people who served ungodly idols, who did not serve God. They turned to idolatry. They served other kings and other gods. So Jehoram, when King Ahab died, Jehoram assumed the throne of Israel, and he himself was an evil king. Maybe not as bad as his father. He took down the idols, but he still served the idols, or the gods of Baal. Well, there was another king, Misha. He was the king of Moab, or the Moabites. The Moabites were like, they were in a sense a captive nation to the kingdom of Israel. There was the king Misha, who was, we had to pay a tribute, or to say, he had to give the king of Israel 100,000 lambs every year, as like his tax, and 100,000 rams. But for some reason, Misha, when King Ahab died, he said, "Don't forget that." Ahab was cool. I mean, he had some power. He had something over me. I gladly gave it to him because I didn't want him coming after me. But you, Jehoram, who do you think you are? Ain't nobody got time for that. Sorry. And so Jehoram says, "What's going on? I just came to the kingdom. I just got my scepter. I'm going to take a sword in my other hand because you know what? That ain't right. So I'm going to go after King Misha, and I'm going to go to battle, and I'm going to destroy him." And then he goes to his partner, his sister kingdom, and he goes to Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was the king of Judah. And he says, "Jehoshaphat, this is what Misha did. Can you believe that? Well, I'm going to go after him. I'm going to kick his butt. And so why don't you come and go with me so that we can annihilate him?" And Jehoshaphat was actually a godly king. He was a godly king who served God, who did not serve the idols of Baal. And he did serve Jehovah, the God of Israel, and the God of Judah. He was a good king, but for some reason he decided to partner himself with Jehoram. He said, "Why don't we go? I will go with you. My house is your house. My army is your army. Let's go do this." So Jehoram asks Jehoshaphat, "All right, we're going to go. How should we go? Should we go through the north around the Sea of Galilee, or should we go through the south through Edom?" Jehoshaphat says, "Let's go south because we want to trick them. We want to do this strategy that it's a war strategy that they will never expect, that we will go through the wilderness of Edom, because the wilderness of Edom is a harsh place. They will never guess that we're going to go through. So why don't we go through there? In fact, when we go through there, why don't we just ask the king of Edom if he'll join us too?" So they go. They go through the wilderness of Edom. The king of Edom joins their band, so it's three kings. Three kings going. Now, what I'm about to tell you is about a party in the desert. Now, it ain't Coachella Music Festival, okay? It ain't that type of party. In fact, this is more like a pity party. How many of you guys have ever partied at a pity party? I'm the biggest one. I can party like no one else with pity parties. Okay, so what happened was, they went through the wilderness of Edom, which was, again, a harsh place, red soil. It did not rain. There were no rivers. It was the wind that blasted the faces. And so all these soldiers from the three kingdoms were going through the wilderness of Edom, thinking that they had the upper hand because they were going to strategize against their enemy. Well, for 7 days they marched and they marched and they marched, and they had no water. There was no stream. So these soldiers were getting, were not getting, they were thirsty. They were straight out of water. Straight out of water. And so they became tired, they became irritable, they became hungry, all these different things. Can you imagine marching with all of your gear and no water? And so they started thinking, you know, man, what's going to happen? God brought all three of us kings here so that we would all die. This was all part of God's plan. You know, sometimes we think that about our own life. You know, God just brought me to this place. He says, you know, all this of no money, no friends, no house, no job, all these different things. You start listing them out. Right? How many, I mean, my wife knows I can be the biggest party animal, pity party animal. And we start doing this. We start listing all of these different things. And then Jehoshaphat says, you know what? Isn't there a prophet? Isn't there a prophet somewhere in this kingdom that can give us some advice? Because remember, Jehoshaphat was actually a good, godly king. And he knew that God spoke to his people through the prophets. And they asked around, and there was a prophet that was nearby. A prophet was one that they could go to as sort of like a go-between between man and God. And they can get a word, they can get some guidance. God, what should we do? So they went and found Elisha. Elisha was actually kind of rude to them. He says, okay, here is Jehoram, the king of Israel, son of Jezebel, son of Ahab. Why am I even talking to you? Like, I can't do the hand right, but it's like, why are you here? I don't want to talk to you. You are an evil man. In fact, you know what? You did all of this based on your own strategies, your own thoughts, what you thought was right. You thought you knew better than God when you first started this thing. You didn't ask God. You didn't consult God. You didn't pray. You didn't ask him for his opinion. You did it all on your own. Now when things get rough, now you love me? We remember George Lopez, about the dad who says, my pain has been in my chest. And this is the dad talking to the wife who, you know, he kind of just throws off to the side and just, oh, now you love me? So it's like the prophet was saying, oh, now you love me. Now you want to talk. Now you want to know what God thinks. And he was so irritated. He said, you know, I really don't want anything to do with you, but because I respect King Jehoshaphat, because I respect that he is a godly man and that you have aligned yourself with him, I will go to God and ask for him for his direction. So he calls in a minstrel. He calls in a musician. How many of you, when you're kind of like all jacked up in your head, and you like you put on some good worship music and just like, you know, just let the Spirit of God just come over you and just really kind of just clear the cobwebs and just give you the right perspective? You think of Elisha. Elisha was a human being. Pastors are human beings. Sometimes we can get irritated with each other. And it just when we get into the presence of God, just know that God will speak to us if we put ourselves in the right frame of mind. And he says, this is what God has asked me to tell you. And it was a weird statement. You know, these guys, again, they had the king of Israel had been dissed by the Moabites. Created this alliance. He decided to go into the desert for 7 days, no water, tired, thinking that they're going to die. And basically what they're asking is, what God do you want us to do? What do you want us to do? Because not only are we thirsty, but we think that the enemy is going to come and kill us. He's going to annihilate us. So what he said that the Lord directed him to say was make this valley, because the wilderness of Edom was a valley. It was in between these harsh mountains, harsh desert, a valley, no water, hard to cross. He says, make this valley full of ditches. Don't you know that I'm tired? I'm irritable. I'm thinking that if I don't do something, I'm probably going to die. And you're asking me to fill this whole valley full of ditches? You mean I have to take like a shovel and dig ditches, which requires strength and energy and endurance to be able to dig ditches? This story was actually something really important. that kind of ministered to my life one time, because I remember that I was asked to speak one time at church to preach a sermon. And I was at a really low point in my life. I was in a pity party. I was in the desert. I was like, you know, spiritually I was thirsty because I was just at a really low spot. And then I was asked to preach. I'm like, really? Right now? You want me to preach? You want me to give something to the people? And there's a lot of people who need to hear from God, and they're asking me to find something from within here and to be able to share it. This is God. I mean, I really felt like what I was saying was, I've got nothing. I've got nothing to give. I'm over here trying to find drips of water to be able to quench the parchedness of my own lips, let alone give water to someone else. Why are you asking me right now? I've got nothing. Then he brought me to the scripture when he told them to dig ditches. And it didn't make sense for a variety of reasons. The circumstances of this situation didn't support the mandate of God. It didn't make sense. The circumstances, when he said dig ditches, what are you going to do? There's no rain. It's dry. There's nothing that's happening. Why are you asking us to dig ditches? And the Lord says, you will not see the wind. You will not see the rain. But you and your animals will drink. And you will have victory over the Moabites. So the water for us to drink and the victory over the Moabites was all contingent upon me digging. Probably say, I've got nothing to ask him to take pictures. So that he does. I don't know how long it took. In the Bible, it's like five words long, but I don't know if that took days. I don't know how long that took. And in the meantime, they were not drinking. But there was something about them responding in faith and in obedience to the word of God that pushed them forward and said, well, I don't understand it. This is crazy, but I'm going to do it because this is the word of God. Well, in the morning, scriptures say that, you know, the armies, they offered a meat offering, like a sacrifice to God. And that all of a sudden, the water keeps flowing into the valley of the blood. You see, while they were digging the ditches, it was raining somewhere. It was raining up in the mountains. While they were digging ditches, somewhere else. He says, when God asks us to do something, when God asks us to be able to respond in faith and obedience, we don't see it, but God is doing something behind the scenes. It's like we want God to reveal his great plan for us. It's like, open the curtains to the stage of my life. What have you written for my life? And we want to open the curtains before it's time. And you say, hold on. Hold on, I'm doing something. I'm setting something up behind the scenes. If you open the curtains too early, you're going to mess it up. Let me do it in my time and in my way. Just do what I ask you to do. And when you do it, I will show you that I have been working something for you. If you just wait and do and act in faith. The water flooded the ditches. And because the soil was like, the Edom means red, which also talked about the color of the soil in that valley. So the Moabites, when they woke up in the morning and they looked over the valley, they saw all these pools of what they thought were pools of blood. They said, these three kings, they had it out with each other. They didn't like each other, so they had it out, they killed each other, and the valley is red. So let's just go down to their camp and let's take all the spoils and plunder the battlefield. And then the Israelites, ta-da! When they get down there, they slaughter them. I mean, this is not language that is for the PG world. This is like rated R. The Bible says that the Israelites slaughtered the Moabites. They destroyed their cities. They destroyed their land by putting rocks over the farms. And they stopped all the wells and they chopped down all the trees. godly people. But that was to have victory, was to ensure that they would not have success beyond this. And then when the king of Moab saw that his armies were being defeated, he decided to send 700, like, through this other way to go to the king of Edom, and they were driven back. The Moabite king was so distressed that he offered his son as a sacrifice because he believed that his god, the idol that he served, that relished and desired death. And so he wanted to offer his son as an appeasement to his god. But it didn't work. And went back to their city. And Israel and Judah and Edom had the victory. So I kind of want to take that story and see what we can learn from this. What do we do when our soul tanks come in? There's three principles that I want to be able to share with you. It says, before God brings to soulfulness, before God brings a fullness to our soul, he asks us to trust him first. Trust him first. So the question that becomes, to whom or to what do you first run when you are on empty? When you feel that your life is a little low, if not empty, you're without friends, you're without money, who's the first thing that you go to? The first person. And what's the one thing? Do you go to Facebook? Do you go to your friends? Do you go to the doctor? Do you go to the bank? Do you stress out of going onto monster.com to find a job? Do you stress? I've been there. I've done it all. There was a time when I was making six figures, and then I lost the job, and I couldn't get hired at Starbucks. No knock on Starbucks. I like specialty coffee better, but Starbucks is good. And I couldn't get a job. And I was so, I'm going to use a Gen X term, I was so loaded. I really felt low because I couldn't even get a job at a warehouse. So I know what it's like when you get to that point and you feel like, I'm trusting these websites. I'm starting to get stressed because when we get stressed in life, it's because we're not trusting God. When we stress out in life, it's because we feel the weight of the demands of life. And that weight is pressing on us like a weight jacket. How many of you guys work out and we have these weight vests? We feel like we're being weighted down with the problems of life. But the scriptures say, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path. See, there's something about the words that the scripture uses. It says trust, depend, focus on, get your strength from, get your answers from, get direction from. Trust in the Lord with some of your heart. Heart. You know what we do sometimes is sometimes when we have like an altar call or we pray and we say, God, I get on my knees and I'm going to trust you with all my heart. So I lay it here at your feet and I know that you will take care of it. Amen. You get up and go, oh, take that misery. I'm still going to worry about it. I'm still going to stress out about it. I'm still going to freak out when things don't happen my way. Time that I wanted. So when we do that, we're picking that back up, and we're not leaving it at the altar. When we trust in God, we're leaving it there, and we're saying, God, I know you got it handled. I know you're good for it. I'm not going to worry about it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on our own understanding. Don't worry about the circumstances. Don't worry what your bank account tells you. Don't worry about what your friends tell you or don't tell you. Don't worry about all that stuff. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness and all these other things in life will be added unto you, will be taken care of if we seek God. Seek his will. Seek what he wants us to do in all that we do, and he will show us which path. How many of you have questions about a decision in your life? Right? Decisions. Do I do this? Do I do that? Samaritan woman at the well. She was caught at her thirst. Scriptures say in John 4, it says, as soon as a Samaritan woman came to draw water again, about the water, she was thirsty. She came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, please give me this drink. Isn't that kind of rude? He sees that she's thirsty. She says she's a woman, that she came to the well to draw a well for her needs. And he's sitting there. I know he's hungry. I know he's a Messiah. But he's sitting there and he says, please give me to drink. And she says, excuse me, but do you know, how is it that you, a Jewish man, are asking me, a Samaritan woman, which you guys don't like Samaritan, asking them to me to give you something to drink? And Jesus says, I love this verse. If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask me and I would give you living. See, because he knew that she really wasn't searching for physical water. There was some thirst inside of her that was longing for something real, longing for something true. The Bible says that she had 4 husbands already, and the man that she was living with at the moment was not her husband. So what that tells me is that she was searching through her life for something to fill this emptiness in her heart, something to quench this thirst of her spirit, trying all these different things. It may not be men or women for you. It may be drugs. It may be money. It may be fame. It may be success. All these different things. But all of us can identify with the story of a woman who was seeking for something to fill her life. And Jesus knew exactly what she needed. Rivers of living water. So when we're empty, we need to thank Him for His provision. When we're sick, we need to thank Him for being a healer. So we believe and we obey. When we're heartbroken, we thank Him for being a heart mender. When we're lost, we thank Him for finding us. When we're without love, we thank Him because He first loved us. And when we do, and when we ask Him for help, He will give us rivers of living water. But this last one, that really gets to me. Before God's great soul for us, what do you bring to Him? He asks you for something for just like He asked the spiritual one, give Him to drink. What He's really saying is, bring me your emptiness. You know, when I told the story about when I first encountered the scripture, and it was about God saying, you know, I want you to preach this message, and He showed me this scripture, and and I felt like I've got nothing. Why are you asking me to share with people when I've got nothing? And this is what His message was to me. He says, you are not empty. You're not empty. You feel like you have nothing to give, but you're not empty. In fact, what you are is full of yourself. So our life is like a bowl, right? That we can deposit things into. And a lot of times we feel like we're so full. I got no room for God. It's like, God, where are you? I want you in my life. Pour yourself into me. Give me love. Give me blessings. All these different things. And He's saying, there's so much junk in your heart that there's no room for me to pour out my blessings. You've got pride. You've got fear. You've got anger. You've got all these different things. He says, well, what I want you to do is to dig a ditch. Dig a ditch, and it's not to just create a hole that is emptiness. What I'm trying to do is to take all the junk out of your life so that you can create a space for me to come into your life. The reason God has not answered or poured into our lives is because we have not made room for His provisions. So we need to dig ditches to rid ourselves of ourselves. 2 Chronicles says, chapter 7, 14, says, then if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. You see all these images. He says, I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins. I will restore their lands. And another scripture is talking about that He will give us direction. shine your light on me. Expose all the junk, all the rocks that are filling the ground of my heart. Remove them. Remove them in Jesus' name. See, the thing is, God gives us the ability by the power of His Holy Spirit to remove these things from our heart. We can't do this by ourselves sometimes. The anger, the pride, the emptiness, the loneliness, we can't do that ourselves. We need the Holy Spirit to come in. But it requires that we obey Him and that we have faith in Him. When we're tempted to question or to doubt this directive in our life because of all the circumstances, we need to believe on Him. So my question to you is, as I begin to close, is I want you to just take a minute to look over the ground of your life. And I want to ask you, what are some decisions that you need to bring to God? Decisions that you've taken to other places, to other people. You consulted the doctor before you consulted the healer. That you consulted the banker before you consulted the provider. What are these things that we have taken to other people or to other things that we need to bring to God today? What are these rocks? These things that are filling our hearts. The rocks of ourselves. That we need to get rid of, that we need to empty in our life so that we can make room for Jesus and for God to come in to fill our hearts with His good water. What are some of those things? I don't even need to give examples. I think you know. I think you know what those things are. What do you need to give up so that God can bring in His presence? See, when we have God, when we have Jesus in our lives, when we think of our lives living for Jesus, we think, well, if I live for Jesus, then I have to give up this, and I have to give up that, I can't do that. People are going to say, oh, you're good too, you're too good for us, and all these different things. God wants you to set things aside because He wants you to make room for Him. When He pours Him into us, Himself into us, there is love. There is joy. There is peace. There is provision. Everything we need in life comes through Jesus. When we seek Him, we know that all these things will be added to our lives. I'm going to ask that you close your eyes. God, I ask you for my brothers and sisters and my friends. I ask you, Lord, that your word would be like this slow sizzle in our hearts. That it kind of just steepened our hearts and just touched them where they need to be touched, the areas of their lives that are being sensitive to your word today. I ask you, God, that when we feel like we're empty, that we can just be honest with ourselves and see that we are not empty, but we are full of the things that please us, and they don't lead to a life of fullness. But that you give us the grace and the ability to be able to just remove these things from our hearts, and that you are here to replace them with all of your blessings. I ask you, Jesus, Jesus' name today, that you restore families today, that you restore daughters and sons to their fathers and to their mothers. I ask you, God, in Jesus' name, that you restore marriages, husbands to wives. I ask you, God, that you restore jobs to people who are unemployed, Lord, and that you would give them a blessing that is far greater than you would ever imagine, God. I ask you for those that are hurting inside, that are broken, and are trying to numb their lives with alcohol or with drugs or with partying. I ask you, Lord, that you heal their hearts and that you show them your love and your peace so that they wake up in the morning, they won't live a life of regrets, but that they will live a life of anticipation, looking forward to what you have for them today. I ask you, God, that you bless them, that you touch them, Lord, that you let them know today, God, that they can turn to you and find blessings, and find love, and find peace, find power. I ask you all of this in your precious name.